Can everyone hear me? Because I don't have one of those voices that carries. I just don't. So I am so honored to be here at the American Atheist Convention on Easter Sunday. Isn't this great? And I want you to know that my kids are okay with me wearing bunny ears at a national convention, but only with three conditions. They said, I have to make sure that the bunny ears match my outfit. I have to wear them like this. And I have to explicitly state that these are Easter bunny ears, not Playboy bunny ears. So we're good. I'm going to try not to traumatize you today with my topic, because it can be very overwhelming and depressing. But I am planning to take you on a ride on an emotional roller coaster called spiritual abuse. So hang on to your seats, because I want to talk to you today about a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Now wait, just hang on and give me a minute before you slam the door in my face. I have good news. Wait, what's that? You're trying to tell me that you already been there and done that? And you think you know more about the Bible than me? But now you have reasons not to believe it? And you're an atheist? Wow, you must have a lot of faith. I mean, you don't look like baby eaters. Well, maybe a couple of you. But I'm sure that deep down in your heart, you know the truth that God exists, right? No? No? So you're trying to tell me that you actually hate God and that you'd rather worship Satan? Obviously, you were never a true Christian. I mean, I want to personally apologize if somebody claiming to be a Christian hurts you and turns you into a bitter, angry atheist with no real meaning and purpose in your life. But I just want to beg you, please, don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. Does all of this sound annoyingly familiar? I thought it might, because I hear this bullshit all the time. Whenever I tell the story of my escape from the Quiverfull movement, Christians just immediately discount my experience by saying, well, your problem wasn't really with Jesus or Christianity. Your problem was that you were following an extreme legalistic cult. And so that's why I'm going to talk to you today about a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. But before I get started, I just want to give a heads up to anyone in the audience who, like me, can't read Bible verses without risking a panic attack. In order to make an important point, I'm going to be putting some verses up on the screen. And if that could cause a problem for you, I am not going to think any less of you if you don't actually read all of it. Because I know that for those unfortunate ones who didn't just take the preacher at his word and you actually read the Bible for yourself, you already know that I'm not taking this stuff out of context. Unless you consider that the entire Bible is out of context and doesn't actually apply to life in the 21st century. So I was in a personal relationship with Jesus Christ for over 25 years, and I'm here to warn you that this dude is seriously bad news for anyone who loves him. Rather than start at the beginning, I am going to spare you the long story and skip straight to the breakup. The end of my life as the Bride of Christ came after a visit to Bright Horizons, which is the local domestic violence shelter in my hometown of Norfolk, Nebraska. I went there to get help in filing for a restraining order against my husband, whose emotional and mental abuse against me and the children had escalated to the point that I was in the midst of a complete mental and physical breakdown. He had taken six of our seven children to a town 3 hours away and was preventing me from having any contact with them unless I agreed to his terms for our reconciliation. At the shelter, I was given a form to complete, and I wrote 3 pages trying to describe the situation in our home. And after reading everything that I had written, the crisis worker said to me, "Well, the judge isn't going to give you a protection order unless you actually accuse your husband of abuse." I told her I didn't really think that my husband was technically abusive, and actually I had no doubt that he truly loved me and the kids. He always put us first. He basically centered his entire life around us. We were a good Christian family. The Bible tells husbands to love your wife as Christ loved the church and gave himself for her. And that's the kind of godly man that I was married to. He was a true patriarch who ruled his home according to godly principles. We had studied the Bible very carefully, and we knew so much about biblical family values that we felt qualified to teach via our pro-life, pro-family newspaper, the Nebraska Family Times. This is how we made our living. And in 2003, we were named Nebraska Family of the Year by the Nebraska Family Council. And that was in recognition of our work in helping to get DOMA, the Defense of Marriage Act, passed in the state of Nebraska. That's not something that I am in any way proud of today, but at the time, being named Family of the Year was enough to convince me that we were on the right track so far as marriage and family is concerned. I had become somewhat of a leader in what is now known as the Quiverfull movement, Christian fundamentalist families who are dedicated to actually living out the principles for marriage and family in their daily lives. Probably the most recognizable and influential Quiverfull family in America today is the Duggar family of reality TV's Way Too Many Kids and Counting fame. Unlike fundamentalist Mormons, who tend to congregate in just a few selected areas, Utah, Texas, Colorado, you can find Quiverfull families in just about any congregation and in almost every community. This is because Quiverfull is not actually a denomination with a creed to sign and a church to join. And it's not technically a cult in the strict sense of having one central leader. But instead, Quiverfull is more of a mindset. It's a very powerful head trip in which each family becomes a cult unto itself, with Daddy enshrined as the supreme patriarch. Based on a literalist interpretation of Psalm 127, Quiverfull families reject all forms of birth control. They have a very high regard for the patriarchal family structure based in the Old Testament, based on hierarchy, authority, and very strict gender roles for men and women and boys and girls. And the reason that you can find Quiverfull families in just about any denomination is because Quiverfull beliefs are not actually a radical departure from traditional Christian teachings. And it's my contention that Quiverfull is regular Christianity writ large and lived out to its logical conclusions. In my experience, the average Christian accepts nearly all the principles of patriarchy taught in the Quiverfull movement. And if you're feeling a little skeptical about whether the majority of Christians actually believe that birth control is sinful, ask yourself, why is it that the religious right freaks out at the idea of having to include contraceptive coverage in their health insurance plans? Whatever reasons Christians give for why they don't want to pay for birth control, those are basically the same reasons why Quiverfull families are leaving their family planning up to God. So while the average Christian doesn't want you to have access to birth control, Quiverfull families are unhypocritically applying that same standard to themselves. We proudly embrace the ideal of biblical headship and submission. We believed, as the Bible teaches, that it is the man who is ultimately responsible for the spiritual well-being of his wife and children. My husband understood that, and he took it very seriously. And that's why he tried so hard to be a godly leader in our home. So the lady at the crisis center said to me, "If he's such a great, loving husband, what are you doing here? Why do you need a restraining order?" I tried to explain to her that despite how hard we both were trying to live according to Christian principles, our home had become a miserable, oppressive place in which none of us were happy, and it felt like we were all losing our minds. The problem is, everything I knew about love and relationships had been so thoroughly redefined by Christian teachings that I did not have the language to name the abuse. So I went to therapy. One of the first things that my counselor, Deb, showed me was this power and control wheel, which is an effective tool for helping abuse victims identify ways in which they have been manipulated, exploited, mistreated, and enslaved. And I'm just going to go over this power and control wheel very quickly just to introduce it to anyone who is not already familiar with it. And if you feel like I'm going too fast, don't worry, because I'm going to go back through in more detail later on. So real quick, emotional abuse involves put-downs, name-calling, guilt-tripping. Intimidation is used to make the victim fear her abuser. Isolation involves controlling and severely restricting outside relationships and access to information. Minimizing, denying, blaming, all ways of making the victim feel worthless and like she deserves the abuse. Using children is an effective way to make the victim feel committed to maintaining the relationship at all costs. Using male privilege, of course. Economic abuse, the abuser will control all the money and keep the victim financially dependent so she can get away if she wanted to. And eventually, the abuse escalates to the point of coercion and threats and actual physical violence. So after going over this power and control wheel, I told Deb that, of course, all of these elements were present in my marriage. It's just that we had different names for these things. We had chapter and verse to tell us that power and control is actually good and godly. We called it agape love. And it's the kind of love which God has for his creation, and it was supposed to be a model for our relationship as husband and wife. For example, emotional abuse involves put-downs, name-calling, guilt-tripping. And I told Deb, I said, this is something that my husband would never do, and there was really no need because I was already fully aware of my inherently sinful nature, my desperately wicked heart. I didn't need to be reminded that my very best efforts were like filthy rags in comparison to God's holiness. Plus, I understood that as a woman, I was particularly susceptible to deception by Satan. How many times when we were discussing an important decision had my husband said to me, "What you're saying sounds reasonable, it makes sense. But how do I know that Satan's not just using you to deceive me?" And according to the Bible, it's very likely that Satan was using me. As a good Christian woman, the last thing I wanted to be accused of was having a Jezebel spirit. Intimidation creates fear. But how can fear be a bad thing when the fear of God is the beginning of wisdom? Was I afraid of my husband? Not in any real physical sense, but I was always hesitant to contradict or disrespect him in any way because God had placed him in authority over me. And God-given authorities can be considered as umbrellas of protection. By honoring and submitting to her husband's decisions, a woman enjoys the privileges of his spiritual protection. And when she resists his instructions, then she is forfeiting that spiritual protection, not just for herself, but for her children. And, you know, I got a little cartoon up here. It looks really ridiculous and silly, but if you really understand this principle and you believe it and take it seriously, it can be very intimidating. My husband didn't intentionally isolate us. It just sort of happened as a natural progression of our commitment to live radically for Jesus. First, I dropped out of college and I quit my job in order to become a keeper at home, like the Bible commands. And over time, we just cut out all meaningful association with any unbelievers, with our extended family who didn't share our enthusiasm for righteous living. We taught our children at home in order to protect them from the godless humanism, which we believed was the religion being taught in the government schools. And eventually we got to the point where we were so biblical that we felt like the independent fundamental Baptist church in our hometown was too liberal, too compromising. And so we ended up at a home church with a couple of like-minded families who were also leaving their family planning up to God and homeschooling their many children. Minimizing, denying, and blaming. This one was obvious to me, because in light of eternity, whatever suffering or hardship I might encounter as a result of this commitment to live biblically was merely light and momentary afflictions. Sure, there were times when submitting to my husband's authority was a hassle. And yes, the pregnancies almost killed me every time. But if I thought that almost dying was bad, just imagine how much worse Jesus had it. I mean, he actually died, right? Motherhood was my mission field. And Christian missionaries often risk their life in their work of spreading the gospel. So if I should happen to die in childbirth, well then, just like those missionaries, when I got to heaven, I would be rewarded with a martyr's crown. Using children didn't really ring true to me, because Jesus loves the little children. And the whole reason why we were knocking ourselves out in order to live biblically is because we wanted to provide a good, safe, godly environment to raise our children. So I told Deb, it's like, using children, I don't think that one really applies. Oh, except for that part where using any form of birth control is tantamount to playing God. And so I was kept perpetually pregnant or nursing or both for more than 11 years. That verse in Psalm 127 says, "Blessed is the man whose quiver is full of them." And it goes on to say, "He will not be ashamed, but will speak with the elders in the gates." And we were taught that in Bible times, the gates of the city is where the men in leadership met to make important decisions regarding local government. So this was about political domination. The whole reason that we were having all this quiver full of babies was, first of all, to outpopulate the enemy. And that would be all of you. And secondly, we were going to shoot those arrows straight into the heart of the enemy. And by that, we meant that our children would grow up to be leaders in all of the major institutions. This was our plan for taking back America for Christ. So children are like arrows, which is the ammunition in God's holy war. So using children, we could put a great big check mark next to that one too. And for those of you who are curious, but too polite to ask what it's like for these quiverful wives who are breeding like rabbits, I have a little story for you. A guy bunny meets a lady bunny out in the field. And he says to her, "This won't take long, did it?" My kids hate it when I tell that story because they say that it's TMI, too much information. I wouldn't say that my husband used male privilege to control me and the children. Male privilege was his rightful position. Biblical marriage is supposed to be a living example of the relationship that Christ has with his church, the bride of Christ. Jesus has all power and authority, which was given to him by his heavenly Father, and in the same way, power and authority are given to earthly fathers. So even though I had heard that absolute power corrupts absolutely, I didn't really think that God-given authority could be abused, because greater love has no man than this, that he lay down his life for a friend. See, Jesus had that kind of perfect love. He was a servant leader, and husbands are commanded to love their wives like Christ loved the church. We heard that all the time. It was our mantra. Economic abuse. Of course, money was always tight, but we had these promises. My God will supply all my needs. I've never seen a righteous man forsaken or his children begging for bread. So it was really just a matter of trusting God and careful money management. God always took care of us financially. Like the time that he led me to deliver my fifth baby at home with just a midwife. And never mind that home birth for me was especially risky because of the health issues which led to my first four babies being born by C-section. The baby and I both survived, and we saved a ton of money. And so I just couldn't even imagine what would make more sense than God's financial plan. Coercion and threats. I told Deb he never threatened me. In fact, I willingly went along with all of the harsh demands of the Quiverfull lifestyle, and in many instances, I was the one who pushed patriarchy and headship on him. Why would I do that? Because I believed that our family had an enemy who was determined to kill, steal, and destroy our souls, the souls of our children, for all eternity. And our only protection from spiritual disaster was to remain steadfastly in that one little secret spot of safety which Corrie Ten Boom had called the hiding place. The hiding place is not any particular physical location. Instead, it's a very specific, very narrow position directly in the center of God's will. There and only there could we safely trust in God's protection. So he didn't need to raise his voice to keep the children and I in our place. And when he did raise his voice, well, he was just speaking the truth in love. When he constantly complained and criticized for all of the ways that we failed to live up to God's perfect standard, he was just hating the sin but loving the sinner. He didn't have to brandish a weapon in order to control our every action and even our thoughts and our feelings. All he had to do was fulfill his role as godly patriarch and love us the way Christ loves the church. So after going over all of the elements of the power and control wheel, I was willing to admit that I was involved in an abusive relationship. And I told my counselor, I said, I want out. And she said to me, you have to protect yourself and your children. You've got to divorce this man. Well, she was talking about my husband. And I was thinking, yeah, him too. I did file for divorce and rescued myself and my children from the tyranny of patriarchy. But for me, the primary breakup was between me and Jesus. You see, being in a personal relationship with Jesus Christ is a setup for dysfunctional game playing and crazy making head trips. According to Christianity, Jesus subjected himself to torture and death in order that we could have the free gift of eternal life. And by free, he means it's only going to cost you everything you have and everything you are. When the very definition of perfect love involves sacrificing your children and martyring yourself, there is no place for emotionally healthy concepts such as boundaries, consent, equality, and mutuality. And I cannot say that my husband's patriarchal behavior was abusive so long as I was committed to being in a relationship with the big guy who exemplifies the abusive bully and who commands his followers to imitate his very warped and twisted idea of love. And that's all, folks.